All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Valparaiso Esports. We are back with some Smash Bros here. And currently, we are just doing a little button check here as we're getting everything set up. But so let's talk about the game today. We have Valparaiso University against, I believe
Illinois
it is
Wesleyan.
Illinois Wesleyan. All right.
Yes.
So I'm not entirely sure how Illinois Wesleyan has been doing this season, but I know they've been doing pretty well, doing very strongly against some strong opponents this season. So it's going to be tough match for us, it seems, but excited to get it going.
Mm-hmm. Going to be a really tough game, just doing our button check.
Yep, doing a little bit of a button check right now, just to be sure. So
okay.
As this gets wrapped up in just a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So excited to see Valpo. Valpo Smash has been doing pretty well this season.
Mm-hmm.
Had a couple rough games, but also had some really good ones. So excited to see how this one goes today.
Mm-hmm. So looking at, I think we're starting with one of our freshmen starting out. So just gotta wait for the button check.
Yep. But it looks like we have already gone through the stage pick process, so this should be a little quicker now that we've tested our buttons, make sure they are indeed buttons. And it looks like we are getting into it. Yep. And as you said, we are sending in one of our freshmen who, I believe this is one of the freshmen we don't see play as often, so it's going to be
going to be
happy to see it. Going to be good to see it.
Interesting.
Ooh, and we get to see it in not a too bad matchup either. A little bit of Kerbo. A little bit of Kerbo gameplay.
A little bit of Kirby and a little bit of Ridley. Never really see the Ridley that much.
These are both pretty uncommon characters in competitive.
Yeah.
So nice to see. That is the nice part about playing some of these universities and other people like this. You get to see some pretty uncommon characters, but Ridley getting quite a bit of damage here.
Mm-hmm.
Having that Nair on Ridley is going to be really big because Kirby is generally really hard to hit. So having a Nair like that, having a move that will cover that much space is going to be really good.
Yeah, the main thing Ridley's trying to do right now is just kind of space out Kirby and prevent him from getting in. So it's going to be a little bit difficult just trying to get out of neutral and get in some sort of damage to get towards that advantage site.
Yep. That is the one thing with Kirby is that he is very low range. So trying to get anything started, especially against someone like Ridley, who has that little bit longer of range, is going to be kind of difficult here, but able to find his openings a little bit with this forward throw into forward air and looking like he's able to even up the playing field a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Gonna get a little bit of that B special, gonna be able to, the B special, neutral B, just to be able to kind of like do some spacing that the Ridley is doing back to it, so.
Yeah, it kind of takes away the Ridley's ability to space with that option as Kirby now has it himself. And then also, whenever Kirby has a hat, it actually is a powered up version of that neutral B. So it's actually going to do more damage if it does hit than the Ridley's would.
Mm-hmm.
But sadly gets interrupted mid-charge, which if you don't know, if you actually interrupt Ridley's neutral B charge before he releases it, it actually explodes in his mouth, basically, and does damage to him.
Mm-hmm.
But does hit with that up B and almost returns the kill.
Almost returns the kill there, but Ridley is getting close to kill percent. It is going to be hard, though, because Kirby is a little bit more weaker of a character, so it's going to require a strong hit to do kill him.
Mm-hmm. Kirby finds the kill there. What's nice about Kirby is that his moves do have some pretty good knockback scaling, so he can actually kill fairly well. The problem is going to be hitting that kill move, especially since his moves power up a little bit more, so it's harder to get those combos into it. So it becomes kind of a little bit of a stray hit game, which against somebody with longer range like Ridley, the stray hits can be difficult, but has found some stray hits, able to even up the percent a little bit here, still at a little bit of a deficit.
Yep, now back at a larger deficit, Kirby is in kill percent right now just against the Ridley just because of his strong hits, but able to get in a little bit better, starting to find a little more of the advantage save, but that will take Kirby out right there.
Yeah, that side B is such a strong kill option and just very strong move in general. It's helpful for movement as well, so going to be difficult. I'm actually kind of surprised that it can hit Kirby so consistently since he's just a short little boy. But is able to recover. Has yet to take any percent back, so this is still okay, but just going to have to find this kill sooner rather than later.
Yep, putting the Ridley in back to neutral. They were an advantage, but fortunately going to be in a risky position. Just kind of trying to look for that place.
There it is.
Getting that kill. So keeping it a pretty even game regardless. However, with against a Ridley, only a few hits will affect Kirby and take him to, like, that's like I see there, about 69%.
Yeah, but Kirby not incapable of dishing out some damage himself. Just has to find that opening, which is the difficult part. But once he does, I mean, Ridley is a big body. He is a big boy, but also is actually pretty light. He's actually lighter than Samus, which technically, canonically, he's actually supposed to be heavier, which is quite silly.
Yeah.
Oof. Good tech, though.
Nice tech. Going to be able to live. Gonna just try and gimp, honestly, right now, which is a very good strategy in the long run, especially if you see this, like, huge percent deficit. But it's gonna be pretty difficult trying to just avoid getting killed there, which, nice job on that.
Yeah, trying to find the Kirby edge guard is one of the things he is the strongest at, but that side beach will kill. Illinois Wesleyan going up by one stock here.
Going up for one stock here, but still good showing from
absolutely him. Yeah, that was a great showing from the Kirby. I mean, as we were talking about, getting in is going to be the difficult part, and he was doing quite well at keeping it even. Just sadly was at the losing end of the trades. It seemed to be pretty back and forth. It just so happened that the Ridley got it first, so it just kind of happened with the trade. So, but good showing. Only down one stock. This is far from lost. So, absolutely great showing. Excited to see what characters they send in next. Again, we don't see Ridley all that often, so I'm curious to see what we'll be sending in and what stage we go to.
Do you know what characters they have? We know. I know there's a good.
I do not. I know two of them. I know that they have a Steve player and then also a very strong Toon Link that I believe had a good run at Supernova, if I recall. But past that, I'm not quite sure. So it's going to be a little bit exciting just to see what happens.
Going to be interesting. Okay. Sending in another freshman here.
Yep. Again, we've been seeing a lot of our freshmen play, which has been great to see. I mean, we did take on a lot of freshmen just on the program, just program-wide, which was really nice to see. It's good to get some new blood in here. So, also love to see that the freshmen are able to just come in and show some strength. It's great. I like to see it.
Yep. So, I like the pick, too, honestly, just because of fast mobility, going to try and be able to try and avoid those bigger hits, but going to need to do a fair amount of comboing as well, too.
Yep, of course. And against somebody like Ridley, that is definitely not impossible here. But taking a look at the characters, at least on record that they've had the Ridley, they've played before, the Steve and the Toon Link. They also seem to have had a DK player and also Game & Watch. And dabbling in a little bit of Bayo, it seems. So, could be seeing some interesting character picks that we don't see in competitive all that often.
Gonna be some interesting character picks, but we do have some DK experience and we do have some Bayo experience. So, not from a player, but just from a previous game.
So, this Ridley does only have one stock left, so going to have to lose two.
Here, but still putting Valpo in a pretty decent spot. So.
Yep. So, just all you have to do here is just take one without losing it. That is all that's really needed here, and then it's even right up.
Still harder to say than do, though. Harder to do than say.
But trying to just find this neutral opportunity, and here it is. Finds the neutral opening, and sadly wasn't able to convert off of it. Got a full hop instead of a short hop. And taking quite a bit of damage for it, but just got to see if you can even this up.
Getting, still just trying to find these little openings and getting them right now, as we can see. Just looking for how to react, but that's going to be a jab from Ridley, going to be to a more neutral state.
Taking a little bit of get off me jab, but you know, that's okay. That at the very least is some information that you can gain. So, going to be looking for these combos. Greninja looking for his openings here. This is not impossible for Greninja to find a kill here, but it's going to be pretty difficult. But this might be a good way to do it. Almost finding the kill.
Unfortunately. Sadly
wasn't ready for that up-y to come on stage, but still very good damage, evening it right up. Just got to be careful. Ridley does have more kill power with the stray hits than you do, finding that out right there with the Nair offstage.
Yep, unfortunate right there. Just barely missing the kill, and so Ridley is going to take a stop going into it, but no, still more than doable. Just got to try and get this last stock from Ridley, and that's going to do it.
Yep. The Valpo trend of losing the stock and then taking it immediately at zero continues. I'm glad to see that trend has passed to even the freshmen.
Oh, gosh. That was the one trend I was hoping didn't pass to them.
It would have been nice, but alas.
So, like we were saying, we were potentially going to see a Bayo, DK, or Toon Link, and Steve.
Yep, those are the characters that they seem to have been played in the past. So, not sure who we're going to see here. Of course, that is up to them at the counterpick advantage. And sadly, Valpo down one stock. Sadly, costing one stock extra to take care of that Ridley.
Yeah.
Which was quite unfortunate. But looks like we are actually going to be seeing a little bit of Speef.
Oh, Steve.
Yeah, they have announced that they're throwing in the Steve because Steve is actually unbanned this season, which is lovely, great, and amazing.
Yeah,
we get to see the blocky boy in action.
So do they have to announce that they're playing Steve, or?
They announce characters before stages. So we do know that they are throwing in the Steve. The Speef, the blocky boy.
Fun.
The Minecraft man.
Oh, so this is going to be an interesting one.
So with Steve being unbanned this season, that does mean he's just an incredibly strong character. We've all talked about that before. It's gone over ages. But that does mean that we're going to have a little less experience against Steve because we haven't seen him.
Yeah, we haven't seen him.
And we don't have a Steve player here because we all hate that character. We're like, no, I refuse to learn him. So it's going to be pretty interesting to see a little bit, inexperience might show. So hopefully they do okay. And it looks like we are actually going to have a little bit of a delay here. They're actually seems like their GameCube adapters aren't quite working quite right. Smash just recently actually had a new patch. It wasn't balancing patch or anything.
Yeah.
I think it was fixing some online stuff. But it actually had an update that messed with GameCube adapters a little bit.
Fun.
And the way to fix it was just to full restart your Switch. And it seems like they hadn't heard that very specific tidbit of information, so they have to reset their Switch, so a little bit of a delay here, but not too bad.
This is fun. I'm not sure who they let code that one, because that's
I don't
a
know.
One.
Yep, but we have at least done our stage picks in the meantime, so it looks like we will actually be going to PS2 with a little
Again.
Bit of Steve. Yep, so PS2 with Steve coming in after this Switch restart.
Yep, just gotta wait for the Switch to restart here. I'm not sure how I feel about PS2 with Steve and Greninja, but it's gonna be interesting.
Yeah, Steve is a very hard one to counterpick stages because there's so many factors to take in. With small battlefield, and FD, the order that he gets materials is actually predetermined. It's preset and it's consistent. But then you have to deal with stuff with, if it's small battlefield, you have to deal with him using the platform almost like a roof to his walls, and it makes it even more difficult to approach. But then if you pick something else, the materials that he get is more determined on the material that he's mining. Like even PS2, if he mines in the center, I believe it's stone that he gets, but then if he mines on the little gray strips near the edge, it actually gives him iron. So it's just so difficult to counterpick stages against Steve just because what he gets is so volatile. And we see here actually Steve purposely using a lot of dirt because on a stage like PS2, I mean, again, he gets a lot of stone and he gets a lot of iron, so they actually want to burn the dirt to get to the better materials.
Yep. Unfortunately, Steve just doing a lot of damage already, just being able to get him in that lock and getting iron already. Just going to be looking for that diamond, though, for after the iron wears out, so.
Yep, Steve's going to be difficult to keep up with damage-wise. He does a lot of damage per opening, getting rid of some dirt. But, you know, Greninja doing well at working around it, just going to have to make up a little bit of percent. But definitely not impossible, trying to find this opening, weaving around the options quite well, but Steve does have very strong options. And here we see this roof getting put on top of the Steve wall. It makes it incredibly difficult to approach that, because now you have something on top to worry about as well.
Yep, gonna unfortunately get hit with that iron. Gonna do a fair amount of damage, just gonna set off, but unfortunately using that TNT to his advantage, being able to use that as a way of killing.
Yep, one of the strongest ledge trapping in the game is that TNT, because you can TNT gets ignited if it's hit by fire, which is his down smash as well. His down smash is lava. But just based on how the frame data works with how the TNT gets ignited, if you down smash when on the TNT, you can actually buffer an air dodge, so you can ignite the TNT but then air dodge the explosion. But the Greninja does go down to Steve. Actually, it's Alex. It's not Steve, it's Alex. My bad. Yep. My bad.
So, unfortunate there going into it. Steve just kind of kept getting that lock on, especially with the side attack.
Yep, getting a lot of percent off of that. Steve, one of those characters who... He's one of the characters who kind of spearheaded the meta towards... zero to deaths, the advantage state type meta, which some people like, some people don't. It's definitely controversial, but that Steve is going on to our next player, able to take two off of the Greninja without losing one. So Valpo, now one full player behind, having to go into a Steve. Who are we going to send in? I actually have my prediction here, but I'm not quite certain on it.
I mean, I think we know who they're sending in right now, so...
Yeah, it does seem to be. I don't actually disagree with this decision here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's probably the best choice, honestly. Saving the air person for anchor is probably a good idea.
Yep. So, going to be... Now it comes down to the stage picks. What stages do we want to see against the Steve, especially for this character? Well, looks like we don't have to wonder for long as Small Battlefield actually gets picked. You know, I don't hate that. Counterpicking a Steve is going, as I mentioned before, going to be incredibly difficult. The different materials he gains, the different advantages he has based on where on the stage. It's so difficult. Sometimes you just kind of have to just pick a stage.
Yeah.
And Small Battlefield is definitely not a bad one against the blocky boy himself.
I mean, going into this, I think it is a little bit better for at least the person who's going in, so they can kind of get like earlier kills just because of the smaller smaller out of bounds box. So
both Steve and K-Rule here are going to be killing pretty early, doing a lot of damage per hit. It's just whether the K-Rule is going to be able to keep up with the sheer damage output that Steve can put. But getting quite a good opening here, but gets returned with the wood up tilt doing 55.
Unfortunate there. That's just an unfortunate combo.
But hey, returning the damage... Returning the damage and then some, this is what we want to see.
Nice! That is a lot of damage. Getting there, barely able to get on. So, just going to try and do that Gim thing. Unfortunately, K-Rule still taking a lot of damage.
Was actually ready to tech that, which is very nice to see. And just kind of punches him up into the magma block because he needs it.
Of course, yeah.
Yep, and going to get a lot of damage here. Wasn't actually able to get the true combo there, but... Hey, still doing 85. Nope, sorry, I scratched that 90 off of one combo opening. Steve has some insane damage output. K-Rule without a jump, and there goes the stock.
Yep.
Able to get the damage, but not able to find the kill is the K-Rule.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, just not really able to do much going into it. And now Steve getting some more damage going in, having to go high, but that is going to leave him open to another attack. going into it, so.
Yeah, the gold actually does augment his frame data. makes his attacks faster, and there goes the K rules, all three stocks. So are down a couple players here. Steve, an incredibly strong character, able to do so much damage so fast, and then able to convert the kills.
Mm-hmm. Just a lot of damage coming out from the Steve, and just K rules just not really finding a way to deal with it, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Was able to return a lot of the damage, but after that damage was dealt, just wasn't able to find the kill. Steve having such oppressive frame data, especially with that that gold, because it's rare to have this, but gold does actually augment his frame data. It makes his moves actually just physically faster. To kind of reference the fact that in Minecraft, the source game, the gold tools are faster but break sooner. So to reference that, they actually made his frame data change, which is incredibly insane because Steve already has some wild frame data, but making it all the faster, and especially on a big body like that. That's one of the things of why we send in a K-roll there, is that Steve's going to be doing such crazy combos and damage that being a big body isn't going to matter. And yeah, he was doing so well, and then Steve used up tilt because it is strong.
Yeah.
Yep, I do agree.
Yeah, up tilt is not fun.
Yeah, but coming in with the Samus against this Steve.
So we are seeing this. You're seeing this thing again, yet again from the Steve, just going to try and do things. Trying to get through, but Alex getting a nice combo, already taking 46%, so.
Yeah, we're going to have to be careful with referring to him by Alex, because we actually have an Alex on the screen.
That is true. That is true in this case scenario, but.
Doing really well. Valpo's Alex is doing quite well, but is going to have to eat an up tilt, able to air dodge out, only taking 30, using that up B, get off of me.
Finding that that up B is just not going to be fun, but Steve has an iron right now, so it's gonna be fun trying to deal with, and Alex is trying to find ways to counter and just try and find that way.
Sadly, Samus doesn't have too many options to deal with Steve Wall. Her missiles actually don't interact with the blocks, which is really quite strange. It's funky. But hey, actually, anonymous gifter gifting Josh a sub. Thank you.
Nice.
like to see that. We don't like to see Valpo actually going down another stock to the Steve. This diamond tools coming out from the Steve, gonna be doing even more damage. Trying to just find the kill option here.
Taking a lot of damage still, and just not finding those kill options.
Yeah, footstool out of shield anvil. One of the strongest out of shield punishes you can have is footstool anvil. It kills so insanely early, and yep, he has been hit four times and taken 50.
Yep, that's very fun.
But just trying to find the kill here. Steve actually is quite a heavy character. It is surprisingly heavy. And that is going to get the kill. Steve coming in, able to take a lot of stocks off of Valpo, and taking us to a round two. Valpo going down into the second round.
Yep, that is going down, but we do still have the second round going up ahead of us, so still going to be pretty okay going into it.
Now you know a little bit of the threat. You know, okay, what can we do about it? Try to think counterplayer, right? What do we do when the Steve wants this? How do we avoid this option? That's really kind of what counter Steve comes down to, is just playing against all the random stuff he can do. And it's just, how do you work around that? It's pretty known that the risk reward is generally in Steve's favor. So it's okay. Yep. How do you work around this? How do you find your gaps? It's difficult, but it's not impossible to see.
Mm-hmm. Seeing another freshman coming out, though, and I like this pick.
No, I actually don't mind this pick. When I'm playing against it, I don't like it. But Yeah, I actually don't hate this pick here. Gonna be against the characters that we've seen, I don't actually mind this pick here.
So, looking for stage bands, of course we're going to PS2, because why not?
PS2, it makes the best games. they just asked whether we wanted to start PS2, of course. The average Smash Bros. Experience, just gentlemen's PS2. And then, you go to PS2.
Yep.
It makes me sad that's the standard, because I prefer Small Battlefield. So I always ask whenever I start, is Gentleman's just Small Battlefield? And I get the weirdest looks, because people expect PS2. It's quite entertaining.
Oh, God.
Coming in with a different character picked on both sides, actually. However, we did predict this a little bit. We mentioned it earlier, seeing the Bayonetta coming out from Illinois Wesleyan.
We are seeing the Bayonetta, but we are seeing a Little Mac coming from Valpo. This one hasn't really been seen a lot lately, so gonna be fun. Gonna be looking for those different attacks and getting a nice amount of damage in already.
Yeah, nice little bit of 30. The one thing about Bayo is, with Bayo and with Mithra, is that you can't really go for too many untrue combos, because they have something called Bat Within or Foresight for Mithra, but mainly, Bath Within for Bayo is a frame one escape option. And just barely missing the down smash there. That actually would have been a very strong option. Now, having to recover, Little Mac, not the strongest off stage, does have his jump, able to make it back with KO Punch here. This is percent-wise in Bayo's favor, but Little Mac, not lacking in the kill power, does sadly lose KO Punch, though.
Loses KO Punch, but still in a decent area, still, like, not terrible. Having that still, stopping that sock, going to try and be able to do anything. Unfortunately, not able to. Going for a risky thing, but Bats Within, gonna kick in, give them the escape option.
Yep, looking for that side B, I believe side B on ledge. It does, I believe if you space it perfectly, it will actually hit on ledge. But there we go, finds the first stock with the forward smash on the landing. That's the thing with Little Mac, sometimes he will just punch you. And sometimes you just kind of explode. Using that to our advantage, getting the first stock here, trying to get as much extra credit as possible. Already 30%. Incredible, incredible to see.
Mm-hmm. We are seeing 30% coming out and not really taking any damage. Halfway to power, halfway to KO, but this might kill. Nope.
Forward throw. Bayo is one of those characters that has a throw that will kill rather than a kill throw. It can be scary on ledge, but not too terrifying center stage, but I don't think this is dead. It is dead. Hey, you know, we take that. Going a little too over-eager on the edge guard for the Little Mac, and does manage to find the stock there with the bullets.
We are up one stock with our Little Mac going in here, so still a good place. Living long, just being able to do a fair amount of damage, but unfortunately, even it up on damage, but we are up a stock, so going to be in a good place right there. And just kind of trying to level up KO, see if we can get it.
Yep, absolutely. This is what we want to see from Valpo, being up a little bit and playing our lead. I like to see that we aren't getting too insanely aggressive with this lead, as some players can get. I'm glad to see that we're willing to sit and use our lead. I like this. With that up smash, super armoring through the grounded side B. A little bit of a jab lock here. Gonna get forward thrown off stage. Should be able to live. Yep, able to make it back, and not quite able to find the KO punch on the counter attempt.
Unfortunately, not able to find it, but just gonna have to keep charging.
Hey, might not need it. Swinging these forward smashes, hey, you know, if they hit, it's likely to kill. Bayonetta, not exactly the heaviest of fighters.
Not the heaviest, and at a high percent right now. Pretty even on percentage field right now, so just gotta look for the right thing.
And that should is going kill? To kill them. Not quite. No? Not quite. Good DI good on DI. The up-B, which is pretty good to see. Actually, fun. Apparently. And that F tilt just boom, boom, killing right there. See, last time it got a kill screen when it didn't kill, and that time we didn't. Just kind of punched him.
Yeah,
You know, when you're playing against a Little Mac, that tends to happen. Seeing Falpo actually go up with a lead here, this is what we want to see. This is the changes that we want to see from the first round. Now we have some stock advantage, which means at worst case scenario, we've gone even with counterpick advantage. That's the position we want to be in. Hopefully we can see at least one more stock. That is the best case. Actually, best case would be taking a couple more than just one. But hey, even just taking those three, you have already done your job.
Get some extra credit, though.
Absolutely. Hey, you know, student athletes, we do indeed love ourselves some extra credit on these stocks. So gonna see if we can get a little bit. I would love to see at least one more stock extra, and actually going to be seeing a little bit of a different pick here. Although it is a character that we had predicted, but we have not seen. Gonna see a little bit of a Monkey Gaming.
Well, I know at least a fair amount of people have Monkey experience, unfortunately.
Every day is Monkey Monday, if you believe.
Oh, no.
Just embrace the Monkey. Yeah, going to be seeing a DK coming out from Illinois Wesleyan. Going to be a good time. So, DK versus Little Mac. Very much a volatile matchup. Little Mac going to be not struggling too much with hitting him. But also going to be struggling quite a bit whenever DK hits back. DK, not a character that struggles too much of getting his opponent off stage with one neutral win, especially with the advantage of cargo throw. That is going to be an extremely dangerous threat to deal with, is that cargo throw. So, especially with a character so grounded like Little Mac, he's such a grounded fighter that grabs are scary, and then you go play against somebody like DK who can kill you off of a single grab. Gonna be a scary matchup, but again, not unwinnable.
Not unwinnable, but
so just a little volatile. Gonna see how he plays it.
Gotta play safe, but with this stock advantage, you can play a little bit safer. Force the Monkey to come to you a little bit, so.
It's definitely going to be a little bit of back and forth. I'm expecting to see a lot of heavy exchanges. Heavy swings in the momentum is what I'm expecting to see this game. So going to be interested to see how we play around that. Because if the momentum is swinging back and forth, how do we make sure that it stays on our half, that the ball stays in our court more often than not? So coming in with the DK, a little bit of electroplankton music, is going to have to lose one stop. All right, so coming in and is going to take a grab, not choosing to throw off stage just yet. But now here's where it's dangerous. DK is not a negligible threat, especially in the corner here. So going to have to find this opening.
So trying to get a little bit of thing, but unfortunately just taking a lot of damage going into it.
And that will be dead. Not quite spacing it ideally. Just trying to hit just the edge of that upbeat to try to not get too framed, but sadly spaced it just a little bit. And sure, that was some hitboxes on DK moment. But now going for the cargo throw and reads the double jump. Trying to recover quickly and aggressively, and calls that option out with the forward air, evening it up. But hey, he had done his job in going and taking three, and now we have counterpicks advantage. So despite not getting an extra credit stock, he has more than done his job.
Yep, we have more than done his job, but now we gotta see who we're sending in next. Who do you think might be a good option?
I am expecting a little bit of a froggy boy.
I was thinking also as well for Greninja, just because of fast movement.
A little bit of a jumpy frog. Is what I'm expecting to see. However, it is definitely not impossible that we see someone else. You know, we could be seeing, you know, another option, actually. It might be time to Okay, that was actually not the option I was expecting. But you know what? I don't actually dislike it.
What other option were you thinking?
I was expecting, I was thinking that it might have been time to do a little bit of a bird up and see a little bit of a Falco, but actually not going to be seeing that, it seems. So I don't mind this pick, actually. Able to, a little bit more of the game plan of, instead of just comboing the DK, which is generally what the game plan is when you see a monkey on the screen, Taking the approach of, what if I just simply don't let him hit me?
Yeah, pretty good idea.
Yeah, what if I just don't let him near me? Which, you know, I don't actually mind the strategy. A little bit of a heavy hitter, you might say. A little bit of a heavy hitter match. As we see the lore accurate matchup here coming in with the DK versus King K rule. The Crocodile Cacophony is playing. Gonna see if the game goes in the Crocodile's favor.
Getting a percent lead and just gonna be able to try and look for those little, just find ways to get that.
The Blunderbuss Ledge Trap is very, very strong, especially with somebody like DK, who's such a big character. He's going to struggle to have options against that. And nice coverage there with the forward air, ready to cover the high recovery route.
Unfortunately, not able to get the timing quite right there. DK going up a little bit earlier just to avoid being getting that Blunderbuss, so just going to have to be taking, but he is taking a lot of damage.
And that was the late hit of up air, able to cover that option and was able to get the stock here.
So unfortunately, DK reading out that attempt to try and go, but that is a really safe
option. That is big damage. Already almost lapped in percent the next stock. And the crown coming in to save him, but not quite able to avoid the second up air.
Coming in clutch, however, DK pretty much giving the crown back to K. Rool, which is not what you really want to do all the time. You want to make sure he tries and does not keep his crown with him.
Yeah, but able to use this crown to keep DK away, keeping him in shield. This is what I was saying, that the game plan of just, what if I don't let him near me? Keeping him away, using that belly armor through the DK up B, goes up 2 stocks to 1. Can you escape without costing a stock? If it so happens, you are already up. But if you can do it, it would be very, very nice.
So
charging up a little bit of a big monkey punch here.
Just going to be trying to look for that
there
one.
There it is.
There is that monkey punch. So going to lose one, but still had a very good thing. Taking several, getting that up air, though.
Into the cannonball. And taking a lot of damage here. See, might have lost the stock, but that didn't stop the momentum. Then with the down air on the ledge, that Blunderbuss ledge trap makes you want to sit on ledge, wait for that gap in between the Blunderbusses. But with that, you can just run off the platform and try to down air you for it. You have to be ready to react for that. A little bit of a mix up option. So going up 2 stocks.
Unfortunate that we did have to lose that 1 stock though. So
unfortunate, but definitely, hey, you know, we take those. A three for one stock. Might not be the ideal trade of none, but hey, that is definitely a favorable trade. We do enjoy seeing that. And the down air on ledge weight was very nice. It is a very good option for K. Rool, and I like that he is looking for that. Those Blunderbuss ledge traps are scary. It makes you want to sit back and analyze the situation. You don't have time for that.
Don't have time, but gotta just see what we're going in. I'm expecting Steve. Steve or Toon Link, probably.
Yeah, I would definitely expect one of those two. Those are the two other characters that they have shown to play consistently as their anchors in past rounds. It's not impossible to see another character. If I remember right, the other character that we saw historically them play was a Game & Watch. But might be seeing a different character than the Steve, I would expect, but definitely not impossible.
If anything, it would be the Toon Link, I feel like. Trying to get some other players play time, but still having a stronger player.
Yeah, I wouldn't count out seeing a Game & Watch player, but I would expect a Toon Link, but not sure. I mean, of course, they will know before we do of what character is getting picked. However, we do have a little bit of insider information. This is nice. So we don't have to wait as much. Oh.
Okay, we're surprised in the booth yet again.
We are indeed. The Valpo trend of predicting a couple of characters and then it just being completely wrong.
Of course.
Stays true. We're going to actually be seeing a little bit of Final Fantasy with a Sephiroth.
I don't think we've seen them play Sephiroth at all.
Not the history that I've seen, at least. This is an unexpected pick.
This is interesting.
Yeah, a little bit of Sephiroth. You know, I actually, Sephiroth, of course, known for his incredibly long range on his sword, but it also isn't necessarily the strongest of hitboxes, so I'm curious to see these Sephiroth against K-Roll projectiles. I feel like K-Roll projectiles are actually going to outrange a little bit. It might be actually difficult for Sephiroth to get in range.
Yeah, probably a little bit.
It'll be interesting to see how he plays around it. I mean, I haven't, that is a matchup I haven't necessarily seen all that much, so gonna be a little curious to see how it is played. How is the Sephiroth gonna be looking for his openings, and how are we gonna deny them?
Just gonna try and see, just waiting for stage bans right now, because you know, takes forever.
of course. And for our bans, we're actually banning Smashville, Hollow, and PS2. I actually like those bans, with the pick of Kalos being selected. I don't dislike it. The bans that we made were, I like them because it bans the smaller stages, forcing us to give us space against Sephiroth. So as much as Sephiroth would also likes his space, having those smaller stages just means that his hitboxes control more of the stage. And K-Roll spacing requiring projectiles means that it's going to be difficult for him to find that footing if he loses it on those smaller stages. So picking a bigger stage here in Kalos is going to give him that space required, as well as he's K-Roll. It's going to be hard to kill him on this stage. An incredibly big blast zone like this, especially on a character light like Sephiroth, gonna be kind of more challenging to find the kill here.
Getting in the first one, but still just gonna be up to be forced to back up a little bit. Going to take a little bit of damage, going to keep it relatively even though, honestly, in the long run. And that is another way to even it up, going to be forced to take a lot of damage from these projectiles, like you were saying before, just being able to really use the miss spacing options. So.
Spacing! God. A little bit of a miss input, but not able to get punished. Interesting. Okay. Hey, you know, we will take that. Stock is a stock, so going up with a little extra credit here, that's what we want to see. Valpo with a lead. This is what we want to see. With a nice damage, getting some extra credit built up.
Just like barely tapping him with the cannonball, just not even hitting. Just barely not. Unfortunately,
that will kill. Yep, the reverse hitbox going to be sending to the left, reversing the up B. So this is what's going to be scary against the Sephiroth, I feel, is going to be the ledge trapping. But once you're off ledge and K-Roll gets the space, I feel like it's actually a little bit more good for the K-Roll. Finding that forward air before the counter could come out, the Scintilla, I believe it was called, his Sephiroth's counter, able to get there before it came out. Woo! That was a strong counter, but hey, K-Roll is a big boy. Tech? Nice. Oh, he teched but buffered an air dodge. I think he expected he was trying to get a tech jump and then air dodge to ledge, but he didn't get the jump version of the tech, so he didn't get that vertical height.
Unfortunate, but
definitely. Hey, extra credit nonetheless.
Still extra credit. I believe that was 2 stocks, correct?
Yes, that was indeed 2 stocks extra credit. So, hey, Valpo is up. An entire player. Mm-hmm. No, not quite. But hey, Valpo up 2 stocks is definitely good to see, having that advantage. And again, we get counter picks advantage of knowing what character they're playing before we even have to pick ours. And then we have the counter pick of having the 2 extra stocks. So very, very good work. Good work coming in with a little bit of a lead here. This is the change we want to see. Having that lead built up for that threat that we established in round one is going to be important. It's going to be critical here. So I like to see that we are able to keep this lead and keep it. Mm-hmm. We got the lead early on and we were able to keep it going. That's the most important part.
So we are seeing a bit of a different pick going into this. So we are seeing
a little bit of a bird up, a bit of a Falco Some nice Falco gaming. I'm excited.
Another freshman coming in. So
absolutely.
I do like our choice for anchor going, hopefully gankering. So
yep, our choice of an anchor I think is going to be probably the strongest against the two strong fighters that we have seen historically that they use as their anchors. This character, a little bit of bird up, is going to be gonna have problems getting in against Sephiroth. That is the one thing that Sephiroth has, is that such long range that it makes it difficult to get into his zone. Once you are in his zone, he struggles to get you out. He doesn't have the best get off me tools, but finding that availability to get in on Sephiroth is gonna be difficult for Falco. Not the fastest horizontally. Mm-hmm. And doesn't have the most range, so gonna be difficult to find your gaps. But once you do, try to make them count. And what does Falco do better than make his openings count with his combos? So gonna see if we can find some.
Yep, and we're seeing this laser come in clutch.
Hey, absolutely. Hey, you know, percent is percent. Yes.
However, we did see an early wing coming out for Sephiroth, so pretty early going.
Yeah, that is actually pretty early of a wing. That is because wing actually does scale with whether the game considers Sephiroth to be losing or not. So because he's down one stock here, or down to one stock, he's going to get wings very, very early. We saw it come out at around 40. So going to be the stronger version of Sephiroth. Going to be a little faster, have an extra double jump, have super armor on his smash attacks. It's going to be a little scary here. Nope, got to be ready for that up B. Can't actually down smash that. The hitbox is aggressively big, as Sephiroth's hitboxes tend to be. Sadly, loses a stock, but hey, still in a advantageous position.
Still in an advantageous position. Just gotta look for this one stock going in. However, he is at 62%, which is going to be a bit of a difficult being forced to come into this fight. So,
yep, finding the opening against Sephiroth, especially with Wing, because Wing does make Sephiroth faster. That was your golden opportunity. Not quite able to combo. The percents weren't looking quite right. But finds the up smash on the end lag of the Sephiroth up air, able to take the stock. Sadly cost one of yours, but hey, keeps the lead. That's what's important, keeping that lead.
Now the question is, who is going to be their anchor?
I am expecting a little bit of Toon Link is what I am expecting to see. Yep, I'm expecting the Toon Link.
Okay. Not sure. We haven't seen the Toon Link, so.
We haven't seen the Toon Link yet, but we have seen them. Yep. For once, the Valpocasters are right on a character prediction. Rare occurrence. We need to get this framed.
Oh, God.
It doesn't happen very often.
I mean, it is like the one moment where we caught two Smash Bros. Players thinking at the same time.
Hey, you know, that too is a very rare occurrence.
That was a rare occurrence, and that was framed.
As it should be. So we'll be seeing a Toon Link coming in. The stage pick's going to be important here. With a Falco, what stages to ban? I would probably ban probably Kalos, probably Town, probably FD. I wouldn't be surprised to see a Smashville ban. Or even a hollow ban, although I'd be more surprised to see a hollow ban than anything. And it looks like it don't matter, because here we go, back to PS2, baby! It makes the best games!
Alright, going into PS2, so gonna be interesting, but Falco will have to drop a stock going into this, but we are still up 2, so still gonna be pretty good.
Yep. Just losing one stock before the opening here. Piece of cake. Let's prove it, Falco. Gonna have to put your combos where your mouth is. Gonna have to find this opening. And now it's gonna be a little bit reversed. It's reversed, but it's the same, but in a different way. Sephiroth kept him away with the hitboxes of his long sword. But Toon Link is gonna be finding your opening against projectiles. With still having a little bit of a disjoint in Toon Link's sword, it's gonna be pretty pretty difficult to find your opening. Able to air dodge through that up air. Can you find your combo opening? Here is one not quite able to convert, but still getting good damage. That's what matters.
Mm-hmm. Still getting some good damage with those combos, so that was pretty good going into it. Unfortunate there going, losing that stock, but still at 53%, hoping to just potentially get at least one stock going into it. But forcing the Toon Link to take about 61 damage, getting them in another combo.
Taking quite a bit of damage, but what matters is the stock. If you can at least get a stock here, then that is what's important here.
Mm-hmm. Right thing right now is I feel like Reflector, just like I've called it, might be a lot more useful.
Reflector is good but scary. It's a commitment.
Mm-hmm. It is
sadly not able to get the back air off of that up tilt. I think there you might just have to settle with the up air conversion, but. Yeah, the Reflector is committal, but it's good for certain interactions. Mm-hmm. The Reflector part does come out frame one and not quite able to live that up smash. The Toon Link evening it up. Now we have a 1v1 in our hands. We're coming in with even stocks.
I feel like the question here is who are they going to anchor? Who are we going to anchor?
I feel the surprise is mostly gone here with the players that we have left.
The big question is, who are they playing?
I don't expect to see anyone than who they have been. Especially with this being their last player, we don't have the threat of the Steve being behind them.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to be an interesting one. Just an even 3-stock to 3-stock 1v1 for the round. This is the game 1v1 here. If Valpo does lose our 3 stocks, Valpo is going to go down 0-2. But if we are able to take this game, we will go to a round 3. So this is going to be a critical match.
This is going to be very critical, but going to have to just try and see what we can do here going into this. See what we can. And just going to start it out right away. Alex going to try and get for those projectile spam because he is trying to set up that camp. But
Toon Link
likes camping too.
Yeah, this projectile game against Toon Link doesn't seem to be working as well as envisioned. Toon Link's projectiles actually seem to be getting the better of the projectile trades.
Unfortunate there. Still keeping it even though. Gonna just have to keep looking for it. Unfortunately, missing the grab several times in a row.
Not quite able to find the grab. Actually doing a little bit of a grab trading, but trying to get this projectile game. I mean, both characters like the projectile game. Bomb actually saving him from the up air true combo there. Just trying to set up, find your opening, but it's definitely not impossible, but Toon Link's projectiles seem to just be getting the better of the projectile trades. Valpo goes down the first stock.
Yep, unfortunate, but getting a little bit of a charge on that charge shot going into this. Unfortunately, finding the bomb with the fire, so going to start that off 44% to 64. Not looking too good for Alex here.
Sadly, taking quite a bit of extra credit. And that's going to be a lot of damage. Probably a kill. Ooh, not quite. Samus heavy enough to live that. And I think the boomerang catch animation actually just saved Alex from an early grave there. But trying to find a kill on the Toon Link here, it's difficult with the projectile wall. Because again, Samus's projectile seems to actually be losing the projectile trades, the trades of the projectiles in the air, taking that bomb forward air conversion, going down 2 stocks. Alex going to have to do a little bit of a reverse 3-stock here. It is not impossible, but going to be difficult. I think was ready for that rollout, but wasn't just quite able to get there in time.
Yep, unfortunate. Not able to get that finishing move. Leaving him at a lot higher percentage with Toon Link just being able to kind of just live at 122%.
That is a stock. Managed to avoid the edgeguard attempt, but does have to take a decent bit of damage. Bursting through the boomerang here with the charge shot, getting some good damage opportunity. Scary air dodge there, but manages to escape with his life.
Mm-hmm. Barely living, kind of on a prayer right now, just trying to look because any stray hit will probably put him out of neutral just like that. But getting back in, still.
Yep, that should be dead. Boomerang into forward air conversion. Valpo sadly going down 2-0 to Illinois Wesleyan. Definitely a very strong showing, though. Not good at all.
Both teams, honestly.
Absolutely. I mean, that first round was pretty devastating for Valpo, but able to turn it around and getting down to an even 1v1 in the round two, that just shows the improvement coming in. So the advantage here. So later on, after today, we have an Academy Overwatch game being streamed at 6:30 Central. And then,
No.
Oh, sorry. Okay. I'm just looking at the wrong day. You know, I'm living in the past. My bad, guys. You know, I'm worrying about the past. That ain't what we care about. Yeah.
You know, the Academy team captain, huh?
Hey, man. You know, I'm tired. School gets to you, man.
Oh,
but but later today, my bad, guys. My bad. So later today, we have League of Legends at 2. Make sure you guys tune in for that. And then afterwards, we actually do have an Academy Overwatch game at 5, not 6:30.
Four.
This says 5. Okay, that was not. I got set up. But make sure you guys tune into that. And thank you guys for watching this game.
Thank you for watching.
And we will see you guys hopefully later today.
Yep, tune in later for League of Legends and Overwatch.
Thanks for watching.